So let's start with week three of practical session about convolutional neural networks and about the features. So I will repeat a little bit of the slides that we had in the presentation, the last few bits basically, and probably just to reiterate a little bit the idea that inside a convolutional neural network you have some layers basically which are being repeated again and again, and if you simplify it, all of the designs that exist more or less repeat very similar patterns, and the pattern is that there is the block which has a lot of convolutions followed by pullings, and this whole block is sort of responsible to extract some features, which is basically to get the image and then extract it into a block of data which is somehow representative and then is flattened. And so at this moment somewhere here, we, after the flattening, we would have a vector. And the vector is relatively small when compared with this. And so yeah, keep that in mind. Today we will be looking at this flattened vector, or maybe not this one, but maybe one from the later stages. And so after this bit, after the feature extraction, we look into the classification part of the network, which is just basically the stuff that we learned last class, which was just a bunch of fully connected neurons. In this case, it's two fully connected layers. Yeah. And so at this point, before the first one, there is a vector, but it's a really huge one, usually because there are a lot of data here. So the connections that are connecting everything from this moment into the first layer, there is a lot of them. Whereas when you step into this moment, basically, there is that amount or the vectors are of that dimensionality as you sort of chose. So because you could have decided how this vector will be, what is the number of neurons that you will use in this layer. And so at that moment, you are sort of controlling the size of the vector as well. Well, and so this is like another moment where we can look at the vector, or another moment is sort of here. And the last vector is basically useless because it's the labels. I mean, it's the most useful one, actually. But for some creative applications, it's a little bit useless because this is the task being done and this is the classification sort of done. But we are maybe more interested about what we can do with these features around here. Okay, well, so this is the strange formula. Or like the compression of that formula, and roughly we can sort of speak about having a feature extractor. I think it can be 4096 numbers. This is basically a very random number. They just chose to have 4096 neurons in these layers, so that's why. I mean, there is probably it's a multiplication of something nice, probably, so there is some logic behind it, but it's relatively arbitrary as to what this size would be. And then we would have a classification, which is sort of relating this back into the classes. And I guess if you look here at this diagram, or even more, I guess, into the real one, so the one which is using the AlexNet, this feature extractor part looks really large, right? Because, well, it's most of the diagram. But also because we can then extract some features from here or something. And so most of the network is actually used for the feature extraction. Well, that looks like that on this diagram. However, the amount of connections, you could sort of look at the number of parameters per this graph and see where there are the most parameters in which step. And that would sort of also hint you at the moment where most of the work is being done, and well, or most of the computation at least, and a lot of that is actually happening between the last bit here, so after the convolutions, and then the fully connected layer. So here there is like a million of connections here, which is crazy, but basically a lot of work is being done here. Okay, well, also that is the fact that there are these smart connections of convolutions which are not using that many connections, so yeah, that's something to include as well. But yeah, this detail is just to sort of explain why maybe we will be using a lot of the network already and just looking at some feature representation here. Okay. Well, so for the the creative uses that we sort of maybe care about a little bit more in this class, what is really interesting is this vector. Because if you have large enough data set, you can sort of plop images somewhere at the start and then receive the classification somewhere at the end. And if this was it, basically it would be a relatively boring system because, yeah, sure, it would be really good actually, like looking at the graphs of the AlexNet of the competition. It's not boring at all. It's really good. It's doing like 10% better than whatever was before it. So I'm not to be shaming it by any... I shouldn't be, right? But for us, this task is something that can be done by many other models as well. What is the important and sort of like the interesting thing which is happening as well is that we can sort of extract or cut apart this network, this thing that's happening here, and really just like cut it here and then just extract these. And sort of ignore this whole part. And I mentioned a little bit in the presentation about the possible uses here. The one I didn't really talk about, and it's actually really used a lot in other fields, in other research fields as well, and that one is really useful, is that if you have a really powerful feature extractor here, you can run any image here, basically, have the classification or have the feature extraction happen, and then using a network which has been trained on a dataset of ImageNet, which is so sort of really big, but so the models that are created there are really good feature extractors, and then reuse these vectors for something completely new. So you could basically learn a just this part, just this classification network, which is sometimes really small. And that would really work with even small amounts of data. And so that is sort of reusing some knowledge that has been observed on ImageNet. So some sort of like the ability to extract features, the ability to extract shapes, parts, maybe even whole concepts. And then let's say that you run some like images that are not from ImageNet, but faces, you would still have some like relatively useful information stored here. And then in that case, you can start reusing that for other uses. So this whole technique is called fine-tuning, and we will probably, well, maybe mention it later, or maybe I will link you to a nice other sort of like notebook that you can play around with that, or I can probably also include it in the other classes. But I really wanted to focus on generation next week, so I'm not sure if we will have time for that. But yeah, so that is sort of one of the uses. The another ones are that this is a way how we can sort of represent our image into a smaller dimensional representation. Well, and so 4,000 numbers is still quite hard. So if you have like, if you imagine that you have a point in 4,096 numbers, and then you have another point in 4,000 numbers, you can do some stuff with that, right? You can start measuring the distances there. Within all the dimensions, but it's really hard to imagine for us humans if we have a whole dataset encoded in these 4,000 numbers. It's really hard for us to imagine how they would be shaped in space. So if you imagine it as 3D, so there are three real numbers, then you can sort of start thinking that each image will get a one point in 3D space. And that's sort of the moment where you can start, I don't know, projecting those points into the room, or if it's 2D, on a screen, and then start seeing, oh, hey, these points are really clustering with each other, oh, and these are really clustering somewhere else. So I guess that's what I would be illustrating in these in the later slides here, where sort of if we have a trained feature extractor, which has been... perfected on a dataset something such as ImageNet, then you can start using these feature representations. And I guess one thing that I didn't really talk about in the class too much is the fact that sort of, to say it correctly, what lies next to each other will sort of fall next to each other. So conceptually, what is similar will sort of fall next to each other in the representation space. And so these two cats would sort of fall next to each other, while an image of some other class would fall somewhere else. And sort of this is relatively huge, right? Because this is something that will give us some measure of similarity between images that we cannot really do when just looking at pixels. If you take this image minus this image, you will have a mess of an image rather than like a nice a single number that would tell you the difference, the real difference between the concepts. Well, in this space, you can sort of actually get the distances and get a real number which is sort of representing the differences between concepts or the proximities. So something like cats would be clustering together, while something like cars would be clustering somewhere here, and another class would be clustering somewhere else. Okay, well, so this is something that people have been using in Google Image Search. Well, this is something that we will basically implement today in our practical session. So, yeah, maybe you're asking why I'm repeating these slides again and again. I guess I'm taking another opportunity to reiterate the ideas and sort of maybe say it a little bit differently, and maybe then it will make more sense when I'm actually doing it in code. Right. Well, so yeah. So this space of proximities between points is really nicely visualized with 2D, but with something like 4000D, which we cannot really show on a screen, it becomes a little bit harder, I guess. But some of the concepts really are still valid, because you can still take the distance measure between two points, even if they are in 4000 points dimensionality. So you can sort of compare them one dimension by dimension, and then maybe sum all of those dimensions later, right? Okay, well, so if you have imagine you don't have images, but you suddenly have a 2D plot, nice 2D plot with a bunch of images, then you can sort of say, okay, I want to start here and go here, and yeah, more or less tell me what is in this region of this embedding or of this representation. And then you can start getting the images which are sort of somewhere on the path between. Well, even in 4000 dimensions, you can probably just check, well, for each point, sort of check what its neighbors are, and maybe look at the neighbors of each point. Imagine that there are hyperspheres around every one of those points, and then looking at the neighbors and sort of trying to establish a path from those neighbors, and maybe just jump from one to another, to another, to another. Okay. So we will also be doing something like this today, and there will be a little bit more confusing code, but it doesn't really matter. What is important is if we get this idea as a concept. Okay, yeah, so I talked about this in the presentation, and we can jump into the practical code. Okay, well, so this is a notebook, I will just say it again, that is originally from the ML4A. Guides, which there are a lot of them, and they are really amazing. Where, and we will probably do some of it later as well, maybe. And just by the way, I was talking about the fine tuning today. So transfer learning is another name for this. So if you want to learn more about transfer learning or fine tuning, this notebook will be something to sort of look at. If you want to reiterate what we talked about in about fully connected neurons or fully connected neural networks, maybe more practically, then these sort of will be maybe the ones to check. If you want to check again more about convolutional neural networks, this is the one to check. Yeah, so this is a good resource. We will be more or less doing these two notebooks today, kind of condensed into one. Yeah, cool. So there are some things we will need to import, some libraries, and then also, quite importantly, we will have to download this, the what is it called, the Caltech 101 dataset, which is a dataset of 9,000 images with 100 categories, and yeah, we will sort of download it and then work with that. So this first command just downloads it, the second one will unpack it, and we can see that there are many images of many types, And in collab, if you do something like .ls, you can get the list of folders because it's just running some Linux there, right? So we are just accessing the Linux commands for some virtual machine, and we can look into this folder and see what categories they have or what is the structure that they have. And yeah, I guess if we look into what Garfield they have these images of Garfield. I must admit, I didn't really know that there are Garfields in there. So yeah, but anyway, so this is a relatively small enough dataset for us to work with, because we can just download it on this basically on a virtual machine, and we don't have to really wait too much. It's not 1 million images like ImageNet would be. It's just 9,000, and they are also relatively small. I think yeah, I don't know what is the resolution of them, but they are relatively more reasonable. Okay, so let's import everything here, all of the libraries that we will be using. And then let's build a VGG network. VGG network is one that appeared in our slides on the ImageNet competition graph progression, sort of, where we were starting with AlexNet. I think immediately a few steps later, there was the VGG network. And basically, it's just another sort of deep convolutional neural network with a depth of 16. That's why it's called VGG, and VGG is a research group somewhere at Oxford, I think, so they are naming it by themselves, basically. Well, so this is a neural network that we will be using. It is relatively similar to AlexNet, and more importantly, it's easy to use because it's already trained with everything inside the Keras. So let's load it up. By that, we will have to sort of call very similar commands that we had last class. So if you remember, we were doing something like model equals sequential, and then something else. In this case, we are loading an already existing model, so we will look at the applications, which means the pre-trained models in there. I guess if you search Keras applications, you will see all the other available models that they have. And so some of them are they're sort of following how the research went. I think NASNet are some like relatively older ones, which are really good but really hard to run because they require a lot of performance and everything. So yeah, but sometimes even the older networks, so even the VGG16 is actually like not really friendly for your memory. So sometimes going ahead and then checking what the other ones might look at or look like might be better. So for example, MobileNet is a network which runs relatively well and fast even on weak PCs, and it was designed by that as well. So Keras has all of these, and what is also important is that it has them with the weights. And so by saying weights equals ImageNet, I think the other option would be saying weights equals none, and in that case it would just load the shallow the model structure, the model architecture, but leave all of the weights inside that model at zeros or something, or at some random initialization value. But if we say weights from ImageNet, it will download the final network that there was at the end of them training on the billion images dataset of ImageNet. Include top is a special one which will tell us the library that we want to also include the last classification layer, because people quite often just cut that one out, so they even included it as a command. Okay, and so the model.summary is something that you know. Yeah, it has to download all of these weights from somewhere. So it's like, I don't know, 100 megs of weights data that they have to download and then apply there. And then this command, the model.summary, is something that we have seen last class as well. Basically, it just tells us, hey, I want to print this network line by line, telling us layer by layer what it does. And so if we look at it, there is an input of 224 by 224, so that is a resolution of image times 3 means RGB. There are two convolutions, there is one pooling, so this would be the resolution to 24 by 24. It's down-pooled or down-sampled into 112, 112. Cool. Then there is another convolutional section. They call them blocks, right? So this is block 1 with conv 1, conv 2, pool. So two convolutions and pooling, which is repeated in block 2, which is repeated in block 3. Block 3 has three convolutions, and then block 4 has three convolutions again, and then block 5 has three convolutions again. Well, so maybe you are starting to see what I was meaning by having a general formula that can be sort of repeated. They have these convolution to pooling, well, sometimes maybe more convolutions repeated themselves as well, and then pooling. And this sort of repeating, and this is something that would repeat in all of those, or in most of these other networks as well. So if you check these, sometimes you can probably see very similar structure. Okay, and so all of this ends up with like the last pooling. We can see that the resolution is always being halved, so 224, 224, 112, 112, 56 by 56, 28 by 28. 14 by 14, 7 by 7. So at the end, you have 7 by 7 image, basically. And you have 512 of them, because each one of those convolutions from before edited that one. Well, also, the convolution was probably combining information from other convolutions, so it is more complicated, but still, some rough idea like that can be used. And so, then we flatten it, that's just a simple operation, and then we connect it with the fully connected layer 1, so the first dense layer. And then there is the second dense layer and the last one. So something like this, the 4096 vector, is actually something that we have seen in the AlexNet, right? So in this case, in AlexNet, they used different approach, different architecture. But the general idea of having pooling and convolutions and then fully connected layers is the same. And even the number of layers or the neurons that they chose here is actually the same in later networks as well. Okay, so one last point before I move on finally is that you can also check the number of parameters. And so this is basically how many parameters are there in this one layer. And you can imagine that there are 128 convolutions, and all of them have a, I don't know how large, it's not written here, but probably 3x3 kernel connected with the previous layer. And so probably if you divide this number by this, you would get the number of weights in that kernel. Yeah. Well, so all of these are relatively small. They are pretty large numbers still, but they are still relatively small when compared with the number of parameters here, because that's above, like, what is this? This is thousands and this is millions, right? So it's over 100 millions of parameters there, which is vastly overshadowing everything from the previous ones. This was 2 million, 3 million, 2 million, 1 million before, and this is even less than that. So that's what I was sort of saying about the distribution of the computation in this graph, where here is clearly the choke point, or like the moment where a lot of the computation is happening. Okay, so that was just a detail. And we will start using this network now. Well, so we could do the same thing as last class. Basically, we can say model.fit, and we can start training it on some x data and y data if we had this. We could also say model.predict on some x data, and then this would give us the y label, basically, what the model thinks. I don't know what else we used last class. More or less these two, right? So this is some sort of commands that we can see again and again, and even if we build the model ourselves or if we are using an already trained one, the same functions sort of work. Okay, so let's see, this is some helper function, which will just load an image and then get us the data in an array. There are more imports. I will download the most important image from our whole repo, this one. And then if we look at it, we downloaded Skitty, and then we can spoilers. We can open that image and then have the model predict that image. And so if you remember, and maybe yes, actually if we look into this slide again, what it means to predict is to feed an image here and get these 1000 categories here. So what we expect to see is that the output of the predictions of the model prediction will be some like vector here of top 1000 categories. So that will be the predictions. So let's see that this is the vector, and because it's just a vector of 1000 numbers, and it is not really user friendly or easy to read, there is a function called decode predictions, which is coming somewhere from the ImageNet handler or something that has been sort of, it knows which category corresponds to which prediction, and so we can decode those predictions and then print out what they tell us for the top five. So this step, we predicted the image of Kitty, and then we showed it here, and then we also print out the most probable five predictions. Okay, and so the prediction tells us, and it's sorted, I think, right? Yeah, and so it tells us that it is an Egyptian cat with the probability of 0.2, a kit fox with probability 0.2, tabby cat, right, and then red fox and tiger cat. Well, one small detail, I wouldn't really say probability, because, what comes out of these networks is not probability necessarily. There was some later research which sort of showed that you can alter these images in a small way, and then it will mess up the network, that they will just start predicting something completely different. And so you can kind of just change the input image in order to get any possible output that you want. And so in that case, it's no longer a probability. It's the confidence. Confidence is the word. with the model's confidence, so the model is confident that this is the image of that thing. Yeah, I'm saying that with the caveat that probability is a overloaded term that has a lot of things attached to it, and these numbers don't really have that properties, so you cannot really treat them as probability. Yeah, which is a detail, but still, okay. Cool. So these are the predictions. Well, basically, up until now, this is the absolutely boring usage of this model, and that is just using it how it was intended, and that is just using it to predict images. And well, I'm saying boring, but still, it's sometimes it's useful, right? You can see that you can start making an applications that would sort of look at images and then start predicting them, and maybe using that class or that label that you get from here for something. But we will go on from there and do something more cool with that. So I already mentioned that we would like to somehow extract the feature representation, so something from here or here, so sort of use it as a feature extractor and then look at these intermediate vectors. Okay, well, so we will actually call it feature extractor, and we are creating a new model which is sort of a subgraph of the original one. So we start with the model input and end at the FC2 output. So if we scroll up, basically we want to copy this whole model, start from image, inputs 1, all the way to FC2 here, and basically we are just cutting out the last one, the prediction layer. Well, we could have probably looked at the vectors here, or vectors here. We could have also looked at the vectors here, but their dimensionality is super high. 25,000, so we don't really want to do that because it's a lot of information. So we want to get this compressed one, right? Compressed representation. But if we sample from FC2 or FC1, it should be relatively same, the behavior, the concepts that we would be getting would be maybe less concentrated on this dataset. So let's do this. And again, let's print out the summary. And that one will basically show all of what we thought it would, but it ends at the FC2 layer. Okay, well, so this is a model. So as a model, let's see how it was called. As a model, we can actually start training it, right? We can say hop fit extractor dot fit, and then if we had some features here, we could start training this model on completely different features. We could also start using it for predictions, so we can predict something, so some x, and get the feature representation. Well, so we don't have this data, so we will not use that, but we'll definitely do something with the predictions. And so if we run the same this feature extractor, sort of run it on the kitty, then we expect it not to get the 1000 predictions, we expect it to get the feature representation. So this is 4000 numbers which are representing the image. I will just, as a sort of detail, add another code here. If I say model.predict, and this will be the prediction, and we print out this, so this would be using the old model which has been predicting the 1000 categories. So if I run it here and I'm lucky and don't have any errors, this one actually classifies it, right? So this one gives me numbers or like vectors or 1000 vectors, and these numbers all correspond to a category. And so something here was actually the tabby cat and the other cats, the Egyptian cat, whatever the classification was there. But I am not looking at, I don't want this basically result here. I want the result of the layer before, where it's getting me this sort of mess. Well, and this is the feature representation. So why would I like to have this sort of mess? Is that this mess is exactly what it, what we can, well, it's exactly this. It's these 4096 numbers. It's exactly the space where we can start measuring the similarities and maybe getting some stuff around the path there, right? Ah, shit. Something here, right? So that's why we want to isolate these features from that point. Okay. Well, so all of this was sort of like showing you the single steps of what we want to do. And now, because we have a dataset, let's do this trick. And let's do this thing for all the images in our dataset. Well, for all images, we would be here forever. So let's just say that like 1/10 of the dataset. There are 9,000 images there, so let's do it for 1,000 images. What it does is that it will just check or find all the JPEGs inside the folder structure, this horrible one-liner. And then until we are reaching this thing, we will basically load up those images. Okay, and so it loaded up 1,000 images as paths. Okay, and then we have features, and then we have the images, which is the... right? I think images will be the paths, and then the features are empty right now, but we want to fill them with the predictions of this feature extractor. So for each of these 1,000 images, we want to calculate this thing, and then save it into the array. Cool, let's do this. Yeah, this one will... obviously take more time. 9 minutes, wow. Okay, yeah, I guess this depends on how fast the servers are right now. Oh right, I'm not using GPU for acceleration, that might also be it. Well, if I am okay, let's change it, and then this means I will have to restart everything, but I think it would be worth it because, so see, this is actually somewhere around seconds now. All of this took us 9 seconds, whereas just running it on CPU would take us like 8 minutes or something. So, yay. Okay, so we have done this. Okay, so there is a moment where we will start doing something that we didn't really talk about in the class, and that is, so Right, how to start? Well, that is PCA analysis. So how I was relating this transformation before, I was sort of talking about it as a compression. So when you see that this is 224 by 224 by 3 images, which is a lot of numbers, it will compress it just to 4,000 images. So in the history of computer sciences, and in the history of various optimization methods and techniques and algorithms, there are some other algorithms which can sort of take whatever these 4,000 numbers are, find the most relevant ones, and just give us them, basically. So it's another way of dimensionality reduction, because we are reducing from 4,000 to whatever we say. And one of those approaches is called the principal component analysis, and in that case, we reduce it from number of images times 4,000 into number of images times 300. So it's called PCA. Yeah, if you would like to know more, I can probably spend some time later explaining it as well, but it's sort of beside the point here. So we have done this, and let's just maybe print out what we have. So, oh yeah, let's see. We have images with 1,000 images. I think this is the paths. We have features, and I think I can call shape, with 1,000 images encoded as 4,000 numbers. So these are the vectors, vector representations. And then, let's look at the PCA features. And the PCA features are this magical reduction of dimensionality that I you can read a little bit more about that if you would be interested, or look at the Wikipedia page as well, which is slightly beside the point right now. And this one is reduced further from the 4,000 vectors into the from the dimensionality of 4,000 into 300. Nice. Well, so now we are exactly in the point of here. We have these images encoded in this latent space. It's also called latent space. In this representation space or feature extractor space, where all of these points now have either 4,000 numbers or 300 numbers, depending on which variable we ask, which variable we use. Okay. So there are some helper functions which can do quite a lot, actually. This one is a function which will get the closest image from the one that we ask it to. So we can look at all these 1,000 images that we represented and then ask for one particular one and then say, hey, if I am in, if I check this one, can you calculate all the distances for every other items in the dataset and then get me the sum number of the closest ones? So let's say 5 closest ones. Yeah, we can. So this is a two-liner which is doing a lot of work. And then this one is just to, this is a function which will concatenate the images together. So it will sort of just help us join the images into just one figure, so we don't have to print them one by one. Okay, and so this is illustration of what's happening. We will query some random image. So here there could be just like the first image. Okay, but we can also just look at a random one. So let's start with the first one, and for that one we will call the get closest images, and then use these features, the PCA features that we reduced, and then let's concatenate the ones that we found, right? Yeah, the results image will kind of join together these images. And then we just want to print them out. So we want to image show the query image, and then we want to image show the results image. Okay, so the first image in our dataset is a motorbike, and the result images in the dataset, so all the other images found that are really similar to the one that we queried it with, are more motorbikes. Well, this is sort of excellent result, right? Because this is something that we would expect for a Google image search to do, basically. And so to reiterate it a little bit more with the slides, we have basically asked the algorithm for gave it this this feature, and then sort of found amongst all the other features of the whole dataset, which ones are the closest ones. So we calculated these distances for all other images, and then got the ones which were sort of the five closest ones. So I should say that we have a dataset of 1,000 images only. So yeah, this one worked very, very nicely. But if we get something with people, well, this is still relatively working, but maybe not for these two images. So we have a small dataset right now, right? The 101 object categories dataset, the Caltech 101, is usually with 9,000 images, but we have reduced it into just 1,000 images. So we even just looked at just like 1/9 of the dataset. And so if the random image that we get here is something rubbish or something which is really unique in the dataset, it will still try to get us the closest, most similar images in the dataset. Let's find one which would break it, and then let's move on. Awesome. Yeah, we broke it. There is a... Yeah, I guess this one is the closest one, actually. Window. Yeah. Cool. Well, so what we see here is that the comparison is quite often done on terms of visual similarity. So there is some amount of conceptual similarity as well, but it's not the same as the conceptual similarity that we would sort of expect it to do sometimes. It's sometimes, because it doesn't really know that these are Buddhas. It sort of considers this, which is an object which looks like this. It's visually made of a shape which looks like head and then a body somewhere. So this is a thing on a pedestal. Well, this is also a thing on a pedestal, basically. But it has no notion of any sort of like meaning of what Buddha images are. Yeah, actually, this relates to one funny thing. In ImageNet, it's more or less distributed, the categories, but for some reasons, they chose to include a lot of dogs. And the reason there, and not just dogs, actually, really finely defined categories of dogs. And the reason there was to sort of like illustrate if the network can A, learn about different objects, but B, also learn about small subtle differences between, like, within one class of objects. So images of dogs, and if it can separate the breeds exactly. Well, so it turns out it can, but what it does to the network is that it will force this whole feature extractor to really focus on dogs. Well, to know how to separate dogs really well. And the really funny part is that we will use these models again and again in some creative works like what we are showing right now, or in some other sort of classification scenarios. And the unanswered question is that if we have a network which is really good at classifying dogs, is it something that can be later used to classify human faces? It can be. Can it be used to generate, I don't know, images or something? And so as a byproduct of some of those generative models which are using the models which have been trained on ImageNet, which is a really long sentence, right? Well, a byproduct is that these generative models will sometimes tend to have these latent shapes of dogs in them. So if you search puppy slug, I guess it's the name, puppy slug deep dream. Yeah, that's the one. Quite often in deep dreaming, you will start finding shapes of slugs and puppies because there are just so many... Oh, sorry for the disturbing images, I guess. But the network is really just focusing on the dog's breeds that it was trained on. And so this is like an illustration that what your dataset was will influence how the models will really work. So let's have a 10-minute pause. We will start with the next part. I guess just one note that I wanted to mention still is that... the quality of how sort of reasonable this this embedding is, so how well it's able to find images, is depending on a bunch of factors. One of them is that something that we talked about just a while before, at the dataset of images that we have now, and we are searching the similarities. If we have just one sample there for one class and then nothing else. It will clearly not find anything useful. And the other area where some error might come from is actually from the original dataset that the first network was trained on. So the reason that it was using ImageNet was that it had 1 million images there, and so the idea is that it's probably good enough to just embed anything. Nice. Well, right. And also, this is a good way how you actually look at multiple examples of the same data in our dataset, right? To find the same image there, because this is not the exact same image. Just by looking at like pixel by pixel comparison, these are different images, but they are basically the same person and basically the same image. Let's move on. Yeah, let's end it on something nice. Let's move on the next part, and that is sort of reusing this this feature extractor for some cool effect, sort of. And well, the cool effect will be this demo that we have seen in the first class, and I will wait for it to load. And the task there is to sort of like look at two input images and then find everything somewhere in the middle of these two. And if you know anything from the, or if you sort of bring anything, any understanding from what we just saw here, is that this comparison will be really odd in terms of just visual similarity, and quite often not really in terms of some logical or some stuff that we as humans would really see. Well, so how this was made is that they also had a dataset, but they had a dataset of images from museums. And so they are probably also using some embedding of, for example, of a network similar to the one we were using, so VGG, VGG16 or something else, probably also trained on ImageNet dataset. And then if we, I don't know what would be nice, like let's see this sort of comparison. Well, they looked at the, yeah, actually they are all graffiti, right? right, so if you look at the, if we embed all of this, of these images of the dataset, and then look at their feature representation, then in this space, you can start sort of looking at the numbers which are the points which are somewhere on the trajectory between these two points. This is something like here, except it is still relatively hard to imagine when it's happening in a really high dimensional space. So let's see it in code. Basically, let's do something like this on our demo dataset. The problem there will be that it will not be as cool as using the dataset of museum samples. Okay. What we will have to do is work with some other Python libraries, and one of them it will be representation of a graph. So out of these out of the points that we have embedded, we will, there is a lot of installation happening, so we can wait. We will be basically working with these points placed somewhere on a graph, and then the graph will be, I think, calculating distances from one point to another point for all the points in the data. So if we look at the data again, we have images here, this is the paths, and the PCA features, these are the 300 numbers of features of the embedded stuff. Okay, we can also select a smaller dataset, but 1000 is already good enough. And then we will calculate a k nearest neighbor, which means that it will figure out the nearest neighbors for each point. And then I think just look at the 30 nearest neighbors and save them. So if you want to know a little bit more, you can search up the nearest neighbor algorithm. We will not go through it here as well that much. We will just sort of run it. But the idea is that we will just like look at all the distances with everything and then save the closest 30 samples for each image. And then we will add, so we are creating a structure of a graph, and they basically sort of adding an edge between 2 points if they are within these selected 30 samples of a distance, or within these selected 30 nearest neighbors for each point. Yeah, anyway, this is, so we can just sort of run it and believe it to do what it's doing. For each point, we are saving 30 neighbors, and then we have a graph which works with these 30 neighbors for every image in the dataset, and just jumps image by image on this graph, and then we'll be able to sort of go from one image to another image following this graph. Okay, so this takes time, because we are always calculating the cosine distance between the PC features. We could also be measuring these different distances, so the one that we were using before was Euclidean. This one is, right, I think, yeah, Euclidean. This one is cosine, meaning we are looking at the angle between two vectors rather than the distance, but it's still a measure of distance, so it doesn't really matter. And then at the end, this is the graph of 1,000 points with 30,000 connections, because there are 30 connections for each one of the points. Okay, well, this is it actually for the class almost. This is the one one final code we will run. We will get two indices, so this can be this motorbike that we found, and this can be another thing that we found. Well, this can be like 999 or something. Let's say 555. Or we can leave it at the random random index later. But this is giving us sort of a handler to between two images. So basically, the code that I was showing was selecting these two samples. Yeah, anyway. Is it loaded? Yeah, so it's selecting index of this image and index of this image. Fine. And then we will call a get shortest path algorithm, which is there are many algorithms to get shortest paths on graphs, and there is a library which will just sort of do it for us. We don't have to manually code this, which is great. And so we want to start somewhere, and we want to get somewhere, and then we want to figure out the shortest path in that graph, and then show the images which correspond to those images on the path. It can happen that there is an image from which doesn't have any sort of jumping point between basically anywhere between here and here with the 30 neighbors, but it's quite unlikely. So let's just try it. And it will be comparing the motorcycle from 0 with a dinosaur from 5.5, and then we are getting this path. So let's change this to get the random numbers there, and then always let's just reuse the same call for the shortest path. And yeah, this is it, I guess. These are the this is the path between a motorcycle and a plane. It's going through some like wheelchair, because this kind of makes sense, right? Like, remember, there is visual similarity happening there. So I guess it's it was firing on these wheels before, and so it's sort of keeping the idea of a wheel in that image for quite long, and then at some moment it jumped into the representation of the plane. And so, yeah. Okay, so this is, I guess, going through a postcard from a photograph to a book makes some sense as well. This doesn't make much sense. These are all black and white, which is nice. More or less. Yeah, so some of them will make less sense. Some of them are sort of surprising. It really depends on how we made the dataset. So this one, the current one. Oh yeah, what is this? Okay, and up until now it makes sense, then it sort of stops. Well, so the problem that we are seeing here is that we have just 1,000 images, and so sometimes the path between two images, if you don't have any samples in the middle, will not really make sense. So, yeah, you probably have to be sort of like lucky to get to get good images on that path, on that trajectory. Yeah. I like the one with the planes and something. Oh yeah, this is also a good one. Like a plane to dolphin transformation. Of course it goes through boats, which is good. And so this is a... So I guess the reason why this is failing is that we don't have a data set of all of these images. And so if we did have it, we could actually run something similar and have more or less nicer nicer interpolations in between these two images, in between the spaces. But the functionality there, at least, is sort of similar. Okay, so this is actually almost everything for today's class, at least for the programming point. The topics I wanted to go through was how we can sort of use these features. So not only to predict some images, image label, as was happening here, sort of classify an image, but how this also extends to the fact that if we have a good feature representation, we can then use it for all sorts of other things, such as these image searches, or such as some tricks between sort of like looking at different paths in the data. Yeah, I guess one last point for this piece of a result, where we are searching for something similar inside the dataset. I was also mentioning the this work somewhere at the start of the first presentation, of the first class. It's the work where they were sort of searching, where they were searching for one input image, and then sort of they have to choose one tile, and then that thing will search for very similar object somewhere in the space. So this is the same sort of approach, except their data set is different. Their data set is maps, Google Earth images, basically, rather than what we have here, which is a demo data set, or what we have here, which is a data set of artistic pieces from an art from a museum's collection. So this sort of shows you how the how you can sort of learn still learn about algorithms and approaches, but at some moment you will still have to sort of search for your own dataset or sort of figure out where these cool tricks and algorithms, where they actually make sense in terms of an artwork. Yeah, let's get back to sort of finish the practical session for today. So for the next class, for the next week, there is no class actually. If you have watched the lecture, this has been said there as well. So the next week will be skipped. And the week after that, we will have a lecture by Rebecca Fiebring. So I'm in contact with her, and we were sort of trying to figure out what to what will be the contents. We are still figuring out how the class will be made. It will probably be something similar to what we are doing now. So some sort of videos that you will watch before, and then some live session. But the cool part is that she will be presenting her work with Wekinator, and that is a sort of, like, I guess, extending the black box approach of you plugging in some inputs that you care about and plugging them with some outputs that you care about, and like letting these blocks in the middle figure out what is the relation there, and then using this as a really fast algorithm that will sort of allow interaction between these two domains. And so in order to get you ready for that, we will have some sort of preparation to go through the walkthroughs on their websites. But before that, there will be two homeworks, basically. One for the next class and the one for the class after that. The homework for the next class, which is not happening, but the homework is still happening, will be an additional reading for you. And that will be the ImageNet classification with deep convolutional neural networks by Alex Krizhevsky. And so Alex is the name that inspired the AlexNet. So this is the paper which talks about AlexNet. And so by now it's relatively old in terms of the stuff that it explains in the paper. But it's still really good as a read to basically understand all the excitement that they had at the moment, basically, and also the way how they are framing those the new things that they are trying out. And so it's a really good read, basically. I think with everything that you have seen in this class, either from last week or from this week, it should be more or less readable, all of it. If there are some details that don't make much sense, then like don't worry too much about it. Just kind of go over the concepts. I will not be asking for like super detailed pieces of information, but rather the concepts. Okay, so I don't have this yet, but I will fill this into the Moodle for until the next week. There will be a few questions for you to answer, and then some summarization that you will sort of have to do. So I sort of recommend going through this paper of like first reading it, maybe highlighting something which prompts your attention, maybe focusing mostly on sort of the intro, then how they did it, and then the results and what they think about it, and sort of like picking some concepts from all of those, because that's the way how you sort of are processing any paper that you're reading. And then compress all of that into some sort of short summary that you will be submitting. Okay, there are some details that you can sort of skim through, which I already mentioned here, and hopefully it will be an interesting read for you. Yeah, I guess for it is a really important paper in terms of everyone is sort of like reading it again and referring to it again from all sorts of newer papers as well. So yeah, I think it's good to read. So this is for the next week. And then for the week after that, because it will be the class that you will have with Rebecca, I want you to sort of prepare for that class, and that will be in following the walkthrough for Wakinator, which is, you can read it here, and sort of just follow everything here. It's not super long, so it should be relatively good. It has like support for all sorts of platforms, so it should be pretty good for all of that. I spoke with Rebecca and she was saying that she will send the exact formulation of like what you should look at exactly. She will send it on Moodle. So you can check Moodle page later as well, and there will be like a more concrete description of what you need to walk through. But this is a good starting point to still go at as well. Okay, so this is the second homework. Yeah, this is something from the class. We talked about it as well, and this is basically the end. So I hope this was all clear, and hope it was good.